Well, hello everybody, and welcome to our Mobile Viewpoint webinar this afternoon. We're going to talk for about 15 minutes, so we're going to talk particularly about one of our products. It's going to be a bit of a productizey type webinar, so we're going to talk about the Baselink. By way of introduction, my name is Mark Andrews. I'm a sales manager here at Mobile Viewpoint. Martijn?
Yes, my name is Martijn van Erven, and I'm also a sales manager at Mobile Viewpoint. And here I got the product we're going to talk about today, which is the Baselink.
So just a bit of housekeeping, really. Everyone's on mute, so you can make as much noise as you like. But what we will do at the end is have a Q&A session. So if you've got questions, you must know by now how Zoom works. So there's the Q&A box. Just write your questions in there, and we'll address them at the end. So the format of the webinar really is Martijn is going to do the lion's share. He's going to do a PowerPoint presentation. But I thought I'd just kick off a little bit about positioning and talk a bit about Mobile Viewpoint and a bit of the history. So Mobile Viewpoint, for those of you who don't know us, we've been around for 10 years. We're based here in Alkmaar in the Netherlands, about 20, 25 kilometers north of Amsterdam. And actually, we're presenting today from AZ, which is one of the Premier League football clubs in the Netherlands. You can see out there, it's a fabulous view overlooking the pitch. And this is one of our customers, actually. And we're in their studio, which is an AI-driven studio, which is something that we've also developed. So for those of you who know us, perhaps that for the last 10 years, we've been innovators, world global innovators in live streaming technology, particularly for outside broadcast and for people who want to live stream from remote locations. So we've basically innovated in terms of bonding together cellular networks, but also with satellite, Wi-Fi, even the LAN, the hole in the wall where people want to live stream, but at broadcast quality. So broadcasters are very particular about quality and reliability. They don't want drop frames. They want low latency. They want high quality. And really, with the range of products we have three sets. And the Baselink, what we're going to show today, is really one of our mid-range encoders. But actually, it is a very feature-rich, it's a very solid encoder. But really, and more importantly for most of our customers, at a real specific price point, which makes it very attractive to many of the people we're using. The Airlink, which is our flagship, it's a more expensive product, but has a lot more features. But for 95% of what most people want to do, actually the Baselink works really, really well. So on that note, what I'm going to do, I'm going to share my screen, and then I'm going to hand over to Martijn.
Yes. Thank you, Mark. Here you can see the device of today, which is the Baselink. On the right side, you can see our other mobile encoders. So you can see it's the mid-range encoder. It's not the smallest one we have. It's not the biggest one we have. And you can also see that in the terms of features we have in the device. Can you show the next slide,
yes,
Mark,
of course.
The agenda of today? So this is the agenda for today. So we're going to discuss more about the hardware. We're going to show you how it looks like. I'm going to show you some screenshots of the GUI. As you can see, it's quite a small device with a small touchscreen. So it also got its custom-made GUI for easy management and control. We're going to show you the workflow, so how you can use the device, how it can work with other mobile viewpoint decoders or social media, for example. A little update about 5G, some use cases, how you can use the device, and a short testimonial of one of our clients, how he is using the device within his own environment. In this slide, you can see the key features, the key possibilities of the device. So it's a low-cost streaming device. It's got an H.264 and H.265 codec by default. So you can select in the device itself in which codec you would like to stream. It's available with 4 or 6 built-in modems, Ethernet and Wi-Fi. So Ethernet and Wi-Fi is by default available. And the 4 or 6 modems is an option you have and can choose between. The device has a small touchscreen for management and control. So you can basically change all the settings in the device, such as delay, video bitrate, number of audio channels, the codec. You can go live or stop the live stream. And you can all manage it via the touchscreen on the device. It's available with SDI or HDMI input, so not both. So you need to choose either SDI or HDMI. Most broadcasters usually use SDI, and we nowadays see more security use cases where they use HDMI. The system is available with different licenses. So by default, we already deliver it with a complete package of licenses, and we can upgrade, for example, with the store and forward license or 4 or 8 audio channel licenses. It's got by default IFB, which means you can talk back from a studio to the device, so you can really tell the cameraman what to do and which direction he needs to point the camera. By default, we also deliver it with a V-mount battery plate on both sides, so you can put it in a backpack or on the back of your camera. And you can also mount a battery on the device itself. And on request, we can provide it with an Anton Bauer battery plate.
Now, there's certainly a few unique things here, I think, Martijn. So people might wonder, well, why do I want H.264 and H.265? Obviously, H.265 is the latest in compression for video technology. It's very efficient. So why would I want H.264 as well?
Nowadays, we also work, for example, with a lot of streaming platforms, and they don't accept sometimes H.265. We can transcode it or make it available in the right format. But if you do it in H.264, you can stream directly to those platforms.
Sure. And also the number of audio channels, I think having four audio channels on such a mid-range encoder like this is fairly unique. Certainly with some of our competitive offerings, it's only their top end really that offer four. And in fact, with our top end, we're offering 8. We always try and stay one step ahead of the competition in that respect.
Yeah.
So let me go to the next slide.
Yeah, here you can see some pictures of the device from each side. So on the left picture, you can see the touchscreen, the power button, and the IFB input, which is a 3.5 mini jack input. In the middle, you can see the other side of the device. So you see another battery plate, which we usually mount on the camera or on the backpack. And on the right side, you see the other important connectors, such as the Ethernet connector to provide an Ethernet connection to the device, USB ports, the power connector for 12 volt main supply, and an SDI input, which can also be HDMI, of course.
Now, obviously, one question we get asked, you mentioned the earphone jack. Does it support IFB?
Yeah.
Yes, it does. So the director wants to talk back to the cameraman, then he's able to do that through the IFB return.
Yeah, and at the top, you see a black cover, which you can put the SIM cards in, and also the small antennas are located under this cover. By default, we deliver it with small SMA connectors, small swivel antennas connected via SMA, but we can also provide a bigger dome antenna, which you can connect to the same SMA connectors.
Sure. So all the modems are internal, yep. And the option is 4 or 6.
Yep. Here you can see some screenshots of the GUI of the device. And what you can see immediately, we use big buttons, very well-known icons that you can immediately recognize what each icon does. So you can see the home screen, which is the one with the color bars. So you can immediately see if there's a camera connected, if the stream is coming in, and you can press the start and stop button to start or stop the live stream. You can press the SIM card icon, and then you can change some settings of the SIM cards, such as APN settings. You can see if the SIM card is connected. You can set the priority of the connection. For example, if you are in-house somewhere, you can use the LAN and the Wi-Fi as a priority number one, and the SIM cards as a priority number 2 or 3. That's up to you. You can change the settings of the video, such as the delay, the video codec, the IFB volume, the bitrate of the video stream. Basically, everything you would like to change, you can do in the unit. But you can also do it remotely via the Link Matrix.
Yeah, I know we've got another slide on Link Matrix, but everything you're seeing right now is obviously on the device itself. But often, journalists, camera people, they're not perhaps as technical as they could be. And they don't want to start fiddling around with the device, do they? So all of this that we're showing now, though it can be done on the device, actually through Link Matrix, it can all be done remotely. So everything can be remotely managed.
Yep, correct. Some benefits about the BaseLink. Why should you take the BaseLink and not any other device? The BaseLink is a small, very small device. I've got one here next to me. And it's almost the size of my hand. It's very light, so you can easily take it with you. So it's really made for live streaming, not that much advanced features, but just made for live streaming with multiple audio channels, for example. It's a mid-range encoder for a mid-range price. It's a light and small device, so you can easily take it with you in the backpack or in your hand on the back of a camera. That's totally up to you. And it's compatible with a range of mobile viewpoint decoders. So it's basically able to connect to every mobile viewpoint decoder.
And it's ruggedized, of course. It's a very heavy duty type thing. It's got
So it's not made of plastic. It's aluminum. It's just a sturdy material. Yeah. So ready for use in the field.
So here's the workflow.
Yeah, this is the workflow, which is basically the same for all of our products. So on the left side, you see the mobile encoder. It can also be a rack encoder. You connect the camera to this encoder. You connect it to multiple networks. It can be 3G, 4G, 5G, fixed internet, such as Ethernet, Wi-Fi, or satellite. And then you can transmit it straight to the playout and use it as an SDI output or any IP stream such as RTMP, RTSP, NDI, SRT. On top of this workflow, you see a picture of the link matrix. So the link matrix is basically the portal to manage and control your live streams. So you can connect an encoder to a decoder. Can be your own decoder, but can also be one of your client's decoders. Very easy in use. Very well-known use case.
Yeah, and rather than I'm a decoder, if people want to use cloud workflows, then obviously we have the decoding in the cloud as well, which acts as an alternative to the playout. So if it's only IP workflows, perhaps if they're doing their own OTT channel, for example, they can then just use Link Matrix to decode, negating the need to have a decoder. I think one of our other strengths on this, which we're showing, obviously we have the channel, the video encoder doing the live stream, but often people want to have a hotspot and they might have a return commands, that sort of thing, maybe remote PTZ control they want to do over IP or just the ability to access the internet. And again, using the device, it can also act as a hotspot as well.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. So we have the internet connections available for the live stream. But if you have enough bandwidth available, we can also use it as an hotspot for your laptop or mobile phone, for example.
Yeah, and it will prioritize the video encoding. It sees that as the most important. So if it does reduce, if the bit rate disappears or the bandwidth disappears, then it will always prioritize the video encoding
as correct.
Well. Oh, 5G, that's quite topical, I think.
Yeah, at the moment we use a 3G and 4G modem. So they are by default 4G with 3G backup. So once 4G fails, it automatically has a fallback to 3G. With the 5G network coming up, we obviously also can adjust the device to work with the 5G network. So we can add 5G modems to it. Just contact us for the best setup. So if you're living in a country, for example, where 4G is just released, I cannot recommend using multiple 5G modems, but just take one or two, for example, and use the rest 4G modems. So just contact us for the availability and the best setup.
Yeah,
some use cases. We nowadays see also more use cases within the security and law enforcement besides the broadcasting. So we all know the broadcasting use cases for news gathering, for example, during sport events, other events, where you use an SDI camera usually and stream it back to the studio. But nowadays we also see more security use cases. So for example, with drones, so you can connect your HDMI output of the remote control to the base link with HDMI input and stream it back to the commando center to keep everybody up to date and provide as much information as possible.
And certainly on law enforcement, I mentioned broadcast earlier, they're very particular about quality, no drop frames, that sort of thing. But security and law enforcement, they're more interested in security. So we're able to support encryption. But also at the receiving end, often they'll have in place a video management system, something from Milestone or Genetec. And there's a standard called ONVIV. So being ONVIV compliant, we can integrate into these VMS systems as well.
Yeah, and here you see some pictures of broadcasting use cases. So you can put it on the back of a camera or in the backpack. And then you can use it for interviews, for example, anywhere on site without having a fixed internet connection and just use the mobile networks. And here you see some examples of the security use cases. This is, for example, in use by the fire department. So they connected the remote control of the drone to the base link and they stream the feedback immediately to the commander center. So in the commander center, they can see immediately what's happening and give the best advice what to do, send out the right people to this emergency event.
Yeah, absolutely.
And a short testimonial from one of our clients in Greece. They build up a large network of partners, which can be freelancers, for example. So they those freelancers work with different broadcasters, so they don't want to buy very expensive equipment to be compliant with all those broadcasters. So they buy cost affordable devices, and they are still able to stream to those different broadcasters in their country.
Sure. And it's worth mentioning that as part of Link Matrix, we have a feature, we call it universal playout. So if, for example, some of our customers are already using a competitive encoder, actually we do have workflows where they can integrate into ours, they can deliver us an RTMP stream, which we can then push to one of our decoders and have an SDI output. So it's trying to make the whole environment more open. So if you are in a multi-vendor situation with multiple encoders from different people, actually that's not a problem for us. We're able to support that as well.
Yep, and we're also able to stream to multiple playouts at the same time. So if you work with different broadcasters, they work with different regions, for example, you can stream to multiple broadcasters at the same time with the same device.
Yeah. Well, good. We'd encourage now people to sort of put their questions in. Now, something we will do is we're going to have a quick live stream, Matthijs, if that's possible. Yeah. So we have an app that we've developed on the phone. So what I'm going to do is just stop sharing my screen. I'm going to use this device to move to the live stream of the phone. There we go. So we're now using an app on a phone. So up front here, we can see the base link. If maybe you could put your hand against it and show the size. That's it.
Yeah.
And then some of the features on the sides. So you can see the SDI input. We got the Ethernet there. The earphone socket on the back. We have the battery plate as well. And primarily, I think on the other side, we have the on-off button as well, which is, from a journalist's point of view, all they want to do is turn the unit on. And then, like I mentioned before, everything else can be managed directly, remotely through Link Matrix, so that guys don't have to be technical. But the point is, it's a very lightweight, it's a ruggedized, very reliable unit at a good price. And here we have the backpack, has the V-plate installed within it, so you can carry both the encoder and the battery all self-contained within one unit. And like we mentioned, it's very lightweight. If you're used to a satellite truck, then yeah, this is obviously a fraction of cost and a fraction of the weight, providing extremely reliable live streaming. Okay, let me go back to Director Automatic. There we go. So we're back in the studio now. So what we'll do now is address some of the questions. Let me just click on the Q&A. Perhaps you could read out the question, Martin. Your eyesight's probably better than mine.
What's the approximate price compared to other products? I think the price is usually more or less the same, but we offer usually more features, much more features for the same amount of money, and overall we are expect a little bit cheaper is what I know.
I always get the feedback we're about 2/3 of the price of the major competitor, but if you're interested in pricing, I don't want to disclose it here on this webinar, but please contact us. So by way of contacting us, if you send an email to sales@mobileviewpoint.com, tell us about what you're trying to achieve, tell us about your project, and we can also advise about the best workflow, the best setup, and obviously we can give proposals. And if you're globally, we have resellers and a distribution network, support network all over the world, and they can help and provide quotations.
The next question, what's the power level for it? I expect they mean the power usage.
Yeah.
The power usage is around 25 watts per hour. That's obviously depending on all the settings you use in the device. If the modems need to do a lot of work, approximately it's 25 watts. And the more features you use in the device, such as storm forward, the hotspot, then it obviously will use more power. With 6 modems as an option, could would 4 LG modems and 2 5G modems be an available option. Yes, that's possible. So you can do, for example, multiple 4G modems and then add one or two 5G modems to the device. So then you can make a combination of 4G and 5G. Indeed. Yes, that's correct.
Yep.
Is there any return input on the camera unit for video return? No, there's no video return on the device at the moment. We are looking into it to add video return to it, but at the moment, that's only available on the Azure AirLink.
So the AirLink is our enterprise product, and it has a whole host of more features, as well as video return. It can do multi-camera input, 4K workflows, and has up to 8 modems as well. So it's horses for courses, really, just depending on your requirements. Do you have special software to counter unstable network? Well, I guess the bonding does that.
Yeah, there's a lot of technology, obviously, in the device that it takes care of unstable networks. So we basically check upfront on each network what the quality is. So once we see that the network drops down, we already notice it before sending over the video, so we can immediately switch over to other networks. And we don't use one network at the same time. We use everything together. So yeah, that makes sure that if we have an unstable network, that we always are able to send over the live video in a good quality.
Yeah. So basically, when we're bonding together the networks, we do it on the strength of each network. And if one should become unreliable, then the software will automatically counter that. And so you never lose packets, in effect.
Yeah, that's correct.
Greetings from Geneva. Yeah, fantastic. Thank you so much. Yeah. Well, I think that's done the Q&A. You have to excuse us leaning forward. We have a monitor in front of us with the questions on and Zoom. I can't make it any bigger, but that's okay. So I think we've done the questions. So on that note, I would just like to thank everybody for joining us this afternoon. If you do have any more questions, or if you've got projects, you need pricing, you want to be introduced to a local reseller, you know, please just send us an email. Again, the email is sales@mobileviewpoint.com. And we'd be really happy to help. Again, thanks everybody for joining. Stay safe.
Thank you. See you next time.
See you next time. Thanks very much.